Welcome to our conversations on artificial intelligence with thought leaders in Africa. My name is Nzele Ndlovu. I am the head of research at Machine Learning Africa. Our aim is to demystify artificial intelligence, ensuring that AI is not just a buzzword, but that artificial intelligence is fully understood by all the participants in the economy, its benefit and consideration.
Thank you for joining us and welcome to another edition of our conversations with AI leaders in Africa, where Johan and I chat with people that are doing amazing work in the field of smart technology. And today we have someone who's doing wonderful things within this field. And I will please ask Johan to introduce Harmony to us. Johan?
Thank you so much. I always say this, but I'm so excited about the exciting things that people in South Africa are doing when it comes to the smart technology era. It makes me so proud, and there are so many of them. And it's, I think, one of our goals through this recording series is to give exposure to these organizations and these entrepreneurs. And I'm very happy and very proud today to welcome Harmony Motsebe, who is the founder and director at Botsa, and who is the Mail and Guardian top 200 young South African in 2020. He's also been involved in a number of panel discussions with the United Nations, and his company is doing amazing things. I love following what Harmony and them are doing, especially on Twitter. And it's all about chatbots and conversational AI and how these things connect from a process point of view and all that. So with that said, Harmony, it's a lovely privilege to have you here. Thank you and very welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Johan. Thanks for having me.
Fantastic. Harmony, chatbots and conversational AI, it's such a hot topic. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of us have been frustrated dealing with chatbots. Mm-hmm. That seems to be a glorified FAQ page. You know, and then in frustration, I've often done this, that I slam my keyboard and I phone a call center, and I'm thinking, I don't know why there's a bot. But you guys are doing exciting things, and AZ is a topic I want to touch on later on in the conversation. But maybe just for our viewers, tell us a bit more briefly about yourself and also about what you do as an organization.
All right. Thank you. By way of introduction, my name is Harmony Motsebe, and I'm the founder at Botsa. So just to give you a little bit of background about the company, we believe in developing solutions or products that improve the quality of life. So the company was founded in 2016. And then in the past 4 years, we've actually helped organizations both locally and internationally to integrate some of our products into their business processes, just to help them become productive, efficient, as well as providing exceptional experience to their customers. So as a company, we've always focused on the research and development of products and services that are powered by emerging technologies in the field of AI, automation, and conversational AI. And with what I've just said now, some of our clients actually, some of the big banks in South Africa, some of the big insurance companies in South Africa, and we also have footprints in Kenya. We also have some footprints in the UK as well. So yeah, in terms of the clientele, we pretty much trying to cover the groundwork. But we're passionate about just solving African problems, because I do believe that African problems need African solutions. We need a lot of localization when it comes to some of our solutions, because we are different in a sense that just take South Africa, for instance, we have 11 official languages. Clearly you can think about the problems that we would have around conversational AI, about chatbots, about whatnot, reaching to the guys that are actually on the ground that don't only speak, one language, but they speak other languages that are not even included in the in the tech space. So you can imagine how many problems we have. So we are a company that is passionate about empowering both our clients and their customers to actually, to be productive and efficient in how they conduct their day-to-day basis.
That's awesome. It's awesome. I like what you're doing there. Automating some of these mundane tasks. I think that's where we all going. You know, adopting these smart technologies. I like one of your products. I know that Johan mentioned that we will touch about Haze. I think it's a wonderful product. You actually allows the customization of the product to any organization of any size, and I think it's very imperative. Sometimes you find that there are some small and medium sized enterprises who believes that or who thinks that AI and all these technologies are beyond their reach. But I think with your solution, if I'm correct, you are able to accommodate organization of any size. Maybe what advice can you give to the small and medium sized enterprises who want to adopt these smart technologies?
The first thing, wonderful question, by the way. Yeah. So the first thing I would say is there'll never be a perfect time to actually start innovating, automating some of the business processes. So yeah. As usually we look at the big question that organizations, that whenever I have meetings with organizations, especially small businesses, one of the issues that come would be like budget, for instance. So yes. The question that I always address is then let's look at this problem as an elephant. So the question should be, how do we eat an elephant? So automation, that's how we ask the question of how do we then automate? How do we automate this big elephant? So automation might be maybe like, just let's automate, the legs. Let's automate the nose. Let's automate something. So like it's always to say let's start small, and then let's start small, even though we have the bigger mindset to say we will at some point we actually want to automate a lot of our business processes, but the goal is always to start small. So that's the advice that I could actually give to small businesses and medium businesses that actually want to get into the space.
Okay. Super. That's sound advice, and it's very true. Yeah, start small, get cadence, get your people on board, get excitement in the organization, because I think people fundamentally fear automation, which we understand. I want to briefly touch on the African languages aspect again, the harmony. I read the other day that there are between 2,000 and 3,000 different languages and dialects in Africa. I've got a Google Home device and I use it often. I switch on my kettle and my TV and my lights, and my 7-year-old son has now also realized he could screw around with me by giving commands to my local little AI. But the other day I thought I'd greet it in a local African language, and I said, Dumela, Google. And Google replied and said, what do you mean, do Mandela? And I thought, that's not at all what I meant. And I think, it's a major issue in many parts of the world, because I think, we've got some very mature and interesting platforms developed in Western countries that are then developed and utilized in Africa and here in our country, but they struggle with local languages. So if we think of our own local languages, Harmony, and if we want to give really good customer support to people in their native languages, how do you guys bridge that gap? Is it even possible? And how does one do it? Do one, for instance, pick Zulu and Xhosa as a start, because that's a great majority of our people? Or do you accommodate as many languages as possible? I'm just quite keen to hear your answer and your approach to localization of languages.
All right. So on our side, we've actually encountered that, a similar problem where we needed to address a variety of languages apart from English. So what we managed to achieve actually was we we kind of like, you know, like used the existing services that are already there. So we can imagine that like some of the issues that we have locally is most of the languages actually are not even documented to start with. We don't have enough data sets for instance, for other African languages. So that's a serious problem that exists, that is out there, that most of our languages are actually not documented. Even if we can bring in the layer of translation in between, still there isn't enough data. So we actually embarked on a journey to actually start working on around like collecting different data sets, but obviously like starting with the kind of solution that we have, because we already have that parameter. We try by all means to collect the data, to create the data in those languages so that we can offer the same services to the already existing clientele. So I think the best way to actually, I would say like it's right now, how we're solving that problem, we leverage on some of the existing platforms like Google Translate, for instance. Google already translates some of the few of the African languages. I think it's Xhosa, Zulu, and Tswana, it's Tswana. So those three, Tswana or Sotho, one of those three languages are already there on Google. But even on Google Translate, even though it's not yet matured, sometimes it can get a little bit confusing, especially from one language to the other. So we sort of like implemented some of the Google Translate layer in between some of the conversational AI product that we've developed, so that we can deliver value, or we can deliver the product or in the language that they understand. So I think the other thing that I also want to touch on is just around the data itself, to say like we do have a massive problem. I think it's a good problem that needs to be solved, and then it's a problem that also interrogates some of the existing languages. I'll just give you an example. I'm not sure if you would be So I want to give this example. Yeah, so there's two languages, right, that, I speak about, six languages inside locally. Well, I can hear them and speak maybe five. So there's a language called Spedi, Spedi, and then Tswana. So I have friends that are Tswana. I'm Bedi. So whenever we talk about certain things, for instance, when I say Kelapile, in my language, it means I'm tired. But when I speak to someone who speaks Tswana, when they say kelapile, it means they're hungry. So the phrase is identical, like it's identical. Like every single word on the phrase is the same, but the meaning is totally different. So those are some of the good challenges that actually exist around the language that could be solved by us South Africans.
That's quite interesting. Very interesting there. Maybe just to look at your vision as an organization. I know that you aim to solve African problems using smart technology, which is quite wonderful. And you state that African problems require African solutions, and you believe that technologies will help in actually addressing some of the challenges that we face. From your perspective, what does the future of South Africa hold in terms of the smart technologies? Are we going to see an increase in uptake of these technologies in the future or in the near future? And addressing some of the pertinent issues that we face as a country.
Yeah, I think definitely we're gonna see a lot of innovations that actually happen in the space. So on a weekly basis, actually, I speak to one or two people that have brilliant ideas of what they wanna do, and how the things that they wanna develop, and not only around my circle, but even when I go online, when I listen to the radio and all the other news channel, I hear about the amazing things that people are developing. So you'll be amazed at how many people are actually working on you know, like different types of technologies to solve the problems that we currently have. So I actually like when I speak to some of the people, they kind of like the picture that they give is the picture that they give and the reality don't match in most cases. Mm. So, but I think given the opportunity, I think people are going to do amazing things. So you think about like you look at you know the guys in the in township, right? For instance, I think the people that are in township, they need, if we give them access to the internet, you know, access to data, I think most of the problems, they would solve them without even the need of government to actually solve those problems. Because some of the problems that we have require a different set of thinking that some of the people that are in power actually don't even think like that. So if we're going to look at the, some of the innovation that is going to come out of South Africa, actually, like we're going to have the, we're going to have the next big thing coming out of South Africa, purely based on the fact that the kids that are growing grow up utilizing these technologies. I mean, they already have smartphones, they already have internet and whatnot. So like with that being said, definitely there is going to be some of the great you know technologies that will come outside of South Africa. So I mean, if you can think about, I mean, I only had access when I got to varsity. So my whole 18 years, I've never touched a computer, like, you know, since I was born until I was 18. So you can imagine, what about those that actually are leveraging on computers from the young age or that are already interacting with these devices? They're going to come with, you know, absolutely like amazing products and solutions that are powered by these emerging technologies.
Absolutely.
It's so exciting. The future of our country, the future of our young people. I want to end off, Harmony, about talking about Hazy. And I know both Zinzele and I were kind of, who's going to ask this question? Because it's so exciting. Roll of the dice said that I can end it off with Hazy. I saw the Hazy, one of your tweets on Hazy, and I had a look at it, and you and I, Harmony, spoke about it some week ago. So, I mean, I hate being onboarded to a new company. The whole recruitment process, the whole onboarding, some companies do it better than others, but the amount of forms to fill in, the amount of times you have to refill in the same kind of information, that in the hiring process, it's sometimes like you've submitted your CV or your information into this black hole and you don't know what's happening. And Hazy, firstly, it's a lovely name and I want to start with that. Where does the name come from? And secondly, for you to just briefly tell us about this wonderful product. And I wish I could have been exposed, and maybe one day I will be, to a Hazy helping me being recruited and onboarded in a much more exciting way.
All right. Thank you. So I'll start with the name Hazy, right? So funny enough, Hazy like it's a name that actually like our team came up with. So usually we're very intimate team in our in our organization. So quite often we think about the problem that we want to solve, and then we do research around the problem, and then we think about the solution, and then the name is the last thing that actually comes. And then usually when we come up with the name, it's a vote kind of situation where we throw the name on like on the table and say, which name do we go with? Which name suits the problem, and then which name actually suits the solution that we're providing. So that's how the name came up. One of our team members suggested the name, and then we voted, and then it was official. We had the name Hazy. So in short or in summary, Hazy is a talent acquisition platform that actually helps candidates. That helps candidates have a seamless application process, as you mentioned. So, but at the same time, we look at the organizations as well to say, like, how can we use the same platform to help organizations automate and synchronize, the end-to-end talent acquisition process? Because you can think about the talent acquisition. So you can think about the talent acquisition process. It's actually lengthy, it's tedious. Both people hate it. Candidates hate the process. Companies also hate the process because there are problems in between. Not this lack of communication in between, there's lack of feedback, there's just tons of problems in between. And then there's the volumes as well, there's high volume. And so what we've done, actually, we've enabled organizations to move away from the manual screening and sourcing of candidates into a digital platform which is AI enabled, and which leverages on some of the existing technologies to solve some of those problems. So I would just touch briefly on some of the case studies or some of the problems that we have, some of the case studies that have actually we've had in the past. So just about last year, actually, especially during COVID time, we've seen a lot of companies actually trying to go digital and whatnot. And one of the things that we have managed to actually to have was with one of our clients actually had about they had the same process. They had their talent acquisition process for that would normally take about 6 months to 8 months. With our platform, they were able to do that in less than 8 weeks. So meaning from end to end, starting with just pre-screening of candidates, just going through the documents, going through the different phases and everything. So what Hazy does now, it sort of like gave them a central overview or a central, a single source of truth for their entire application process. So yeah, so that's what Hazy does. That's what Hazy is about and the problems that it addresses. But yeah, there's more to that we can talk about.
Awesome. Harmony, thank you so much, man. Because of time, I think there's a lot that surely we would need to talk about when it comes to this technology, the kind of innovations that you are doing there. But it's been a pleasure chatting with you, and hopefully you'll be able to join us next time as we expound on these topics in the future.